Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nasta'hdihi wa nasta'afiruh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, our Sahabi for today is Suhaib Bin Sinan Arroumi, Al-Raba'i Al-Namri, radiyallahu anhu. Suhaib, and he's known for short, Suhaib Arroumi, was born in the desert of Syria in the north on the Euphrates from an Arabic tribe, which is named Bani Namr ibn Qasid. And they were from the Manadhira, who are surrogate for the Persians. On the other hand, you have some people, Arabs from Syria, they are Al-Ghassasina, and they are surrogates to Byzantine. And usually those two parts are the proxy for the big powers, and they have them fight together to let out some of the steam. And one of those expeditions or fighting of the Romans against the Persian, the first line of defense is Al-Manazira, or those Arabs from the area of the Euphrates and Tigris. Captured many people of that area, including a young boy with the name Suhaib. His father was a governor, and so his uncle was high in the ranks. And they lived in an area close to Nainawa and close to Al-Mosul, nowadays city. So they are from that area. So that young kid was taken by the Romans, and he was enslaved, and he lived among the Romans, and he spoke their language fluently, which affected his mother tongue language, which he spoke it in a broken way. And maybe this is the main reason he was called Suhaib Arroumi. I remember my kids when they used to go back to where I came from, and they play in the neighborhood with the other kids. When they come, the kids of the neighborhood, they would run and say, "The American has come, the American has come." So that's why Suhaib been called Arroumi. After apparently came a his teens or early 20s, he was sold to Mecca. And the one who bought him was Abdullah ibn Jud'an at-Taymi. Abdullah ibn Jud'an is a great figure in the Jahiliyyah. He was of the generation of Abdul Muttalib and Abu Talib. The first time we meet Abdullah ibn Jud'an is in Hilf al-Fudul. You remember Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was 14, 15 years of age when a big gathering at his house was where the great figures of Quraysh met and agreed to establish justice for everyone, including the weak and the foreigners, and to serve justice in case of problems. And he was a very generous man. And probably in the same time, and maybe in the same event, there was big celebrations and a lot of food and dessert from Syria. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as teenager, met Abu Jahl, who was a few years older and much bigger apparently, and he tried to bully Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they had some kind of pushing on the bench or something, and Abu Jahl fell on his knee, and he scratched his knee and left a mark, lifelong mark. When he died in Badr, that mark was the scar which they identified him by it. So now he is the servant of Abdullah ibn Jud'an. He worked in business. He excelled at it. And apparently he gained his freedom, stayed as a servant or mawla or connected to Bani Jud'an, Abdullah ibn Jud'an at-Taymi. And as a sport, he excelled in archery. So he was a sharp shooter with the arrows. And when Islam started in Mecca, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called the people to worship of God and to leave all the idols, the news came to the ears of Suhaib. He became curious and went to check it out. And that was after the first 3 years, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in the house, which became like the center of the da'wah, the house of Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam Al-Makhzumi. So Suhaib went there, and the minute he arrived, another man with the name Ammar ibn Yasir arrived, and both of them knocked on the door, and he asked him, "What you're doing here?" He told him, "I came to listen to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." And the door was opened, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received them and recited Quran to them and invited them to worship God and to be good, the moral values, to take care of parents and to be good to your relatives, to be good to your neighbors, and to give charity, to help the weak, the women, the orphans, and so on. So he became Muslim after 30 plus of people who became Muslim before him. And he was of al-mustadafin. Al-mustadafin are those who do not have support from their families or tribe. So they are like second-class citizens. in Mecca. Usually the foreigners, the slaves or the freed slaves and so on, those are al-mustada'afin. Because in the code of the Jahiliyyah, if you are from a strong tribe, if you are right or wrong, you find 100,000 people behind you. That's why Bani Makhzum or Bani Adi or Bani Umayyah or so this is the Jahiliyyah. So he was from Mustadafin in Mecca. That means he and those who are alike him received the torture and the punishments and the wrath of the big leaders of Quraysh to let it out of their frustration with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his strong followers. So Suhaib Arroumi, they used to torture him by putting on him iron armor and put him in the sun at 120, 130 degrees for hours and hours. And he suffered like Bilal ibn Rabah, he suffered like Khabbab ibn al-Arat, he suffered like Ammar ibn Yasir and his mother Sumayya bint al-Khayyat, who was killed at the end of the torture sessions, and she was the first victim or the first martyr in Islam. She was a woman. And when things started easing off after the two hijra to Abbasin and then Bayat al-Aqaba and so on, and the news came that a deal was struck between Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the people of Yathrib, and the arrangements was made for Muslims to migrate from Mecca to Medina, so they will have their home there. So the Muslims started going there, starting with Mus'ab ibn Umayr, who prepared the scene for 2 years before Hijrah. And Abdullah ibn Umm Maktoum also, he was there, and the groups of Muslims started migrating after they were given the permission. And we know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was almost the last one who abandoned the ship. He was the last who leave Mecca. And the plan was for Suhaib to be his companion with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. But things did not go the way Suhaib wanted, and he stayed behind. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, as we know, stayed after with an order from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, stayed in his house for a very important reason, and that is to return the deposits of people back to them. You know, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with his statue, he was al-qawi al-amin. And the people of Quraysh, they have no banking system. They have no safety deposit boxes to rent. They would trust their valuables, their gold, their jewels, and everything precious in their possession with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for no fees. Just they trust him, and they put their valuable with him. And after 13 years of what they have done to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of abuse, verbal, physical, slander, everything you can imagine, all of it depicted in the Quran. We don't need any other source. The person would have some grudge in his heart, say, well, you know, I have now their probably a big amount of their wealth. I'm gonna take it, let them go to, you know, H-E-L-L, but this is not Islam. This is not Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the trustworthy. Those people who hurt him, he waited, he sacrificed, he endangered his own son-in-law and his cousin, Ali ibn Abi Talib, by leaving him behind. And you know that there were 10 strong men with swords surrounded the house of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ready to kill him. And they did not find Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can imagine the frustration they had, especially they are paid assassins, killers by Quraysh, those big chieftains. And they found Ali radiallahu anhu. They could have killed him out of anger and rage. So Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu stayed behind to return the money to its owners. And God knows, maybe Abu Jahl, maybe Abu Lahab, maybe Abu Sufyan, maybe any of those great figures of Quraysh, maybe their money was with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not freeze it. He did not confiscate them. Because the amana, like justice, like honesty, is done to everyone, regardless of your love or hate or any other circumstances. This is in Islam. So Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh did his job and returned the deposits to their owners and did the migration. And Suhaib was the last one of this group. We know that the migration was a continuous process all the way to Fatah Mecca. But in that first group who left, which 200 plus of the Muslims, Suhaib was the last one. Now what happened with Suhaib, that he wanted to make the hijrah, and as we have said, Suhaib was very close to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to Abu Bakr Siddiq, and he could have been a third person to be with them in the hijrah, but things did not work that way. And when he went, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Quba when he started his migration. And unfortunately, Quraysh knew about it, and they had some small army or small people to intercept him and to prevent him from leaving. And they told him, you come to us as a servant, as a slave, and you make money in our land and our city, and now you want to flee that easy? So he told them, Suhaib was a very courageous man. Told him, look, you know me, I'm an archer, and I'm the best. And I have here in my bag so many arrows. You would not touch me till I kill so many people of you with these arrows. Then I have a sword. I will fight you till I die. So here he's trying to show them that their loss will be big of men. Then he gave them the enticement. So he used the carrot and the stick, you know, policy. And he told them, look, the money you're talking to me about, I didn't take it with me. It's at my home. And if you let me go, I will tell you where's the gold and the money. And Quraysh, of course, they weighed things. And they said, well, we don't want any one of us to be killed, and there's gold. So they agreed. So Suhaib told them the gold in that area, so and so, so I gave him, and he was honest, as every Muslim should be, and they let him go. And when he arrived to Medina, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting, and when he saw him coming with the Sahaba around him, he told them, before even saying salam, رَبِحَ الْبَيْعَ أَبَا يَحْيَا رَبِحَ الْبَيْعَ أَبَا يَحْيَا. That means your deal was successful, O Suhaib. Abu Yahya, Suhaib did not have children, And this is the first time he heard the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam call him Aba Yahya. So he loved that name and he kept it for the rest of his life. As a matter of fact, Umar ibn al-Khattab, who loves Suhaib so much and he knows everything, but he wanted to joke with him, and he told him, why you are Abu Yahya and you have no Yahya, and you have no son? He told him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called me with that name and I will never replace it with anything else. So when he heard that, he told him, O Prophet of Allah, nobody knows what happened between me and Quraysh. I'm just coming fresh. I mean, the news did not take, you know, it takes time to arrive. Not like nowadays, the iPhone and forwarding messages. It's the speed of light. How did you know? I mean, I'm sure it's a revelation. So it is Jibreel alayhi salam who did that. وَمَا أَخْبَرَكَ إِلَّا جِبْرِيلٌ. And this is what it was. You know, one time when Khabbab ibn Adi was crucified in Mecca, and he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give salam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was in the Medina, and instantly Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Khubayb yuqri'ukum as-salam. So this communication for the Sahaba, it was something becoming very usual, and they had no doubt or questions about it. Jibreel alayhi salam comes with the news, with the events, and so on. Even Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when they told him about the migration, Isra and Mi'raj, they say, I mean, this is unbelievable, you know, for him to leave, a journey take us 2 months in a split part of the night. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq told him, in qalaha faqad sadaq. If Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said he went to Jerusalem, then when he went to heaven, he's telling the truth. And why not for me to believe in him, and I believe in him, in Jibreel coming down every day with a lot of things. So for the Sahaba al-Kiram, the presence of Jibreel alayhi salam was smelled or felt, and in their consciousness, I mean, they had no doubt about it. Even we know when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, and his babysitter who lived all his life and died after him 6 months, Ayman. And she cried so hard after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Abu Bakr and Umar came to her and told her, you know, this is a fact of life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, innaka mayitun wa innahum mayitun. He's gonna die and you are gonna die. Why you're crying that much? He told him, yeah, I know that, but I'm crying for the severance of heaven touch with the earth. She was missing Jibreel and the angels, and they had felt it. Every one of them, they feel that presence. And that what gives them big advantage over us, and who are believing based on, you know, what we hear. That's why we are called the brothers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the Sahaba, they had the evidence there. They lived it. For us, we have received second-hand information. Of course, we use our brain, mind to look at heaven, earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, creation, and so on, and the honesty and truth of the descendant of the information to us. That's why he called us his brothers. When the Sahaba told them, aren't we your brothers? I know, you are my companion. My brothers, those who will come later and believe in me, and they haven't seen me. So, Suhaib, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Rabih al-Bay' Aba Yahya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Quran. We read it every day, and it will be read till the day of judgment. That ayah was revealed on behalf of Suhaib and what he did when he ransomed his iman and faith and migrated to Medina. He ransomed all his wealth and went there only with his clothes on him. And that ayah, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْرِي نَفْسَهُ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ رَؤُوفٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. Suhaib, became a constant companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He lived with a man from the Ansar after the matching, the pairing. His name is Al-Harith ibn Simma. So they were become brothers. And he became 24 hours constant companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He attended everyday activity. He attended all treaties. He attended every expedition happened with the presence of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam dispatched groups, he would be the first in those groups. And the difference, the one's expeditions with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam there as a leader, it's called the Ghazwa, and those expeditions which he dispatched and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam stays in Medina is called Sariya. So Suhaib himself is telling us what he did. He said, لم يشهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مشهدا قط إلا كنت حاضرة. All the events till he died, I was an eyewitness. I was there. ولم يبايع بيعة قط إلا كنت حاضرة. And any bay'ah, which means the agreement or contract or like bay'at al-Radwan and so on, I was there. وَلَمْ يُسْرِ سَرِيَّةً قَطْ إِلَّا كُنْتُ حَاضِرُهَا وَلَا غَزَى غَزْوَةً قَطْ إِلَّا كُنْتُ فِيهَا عَنْ يَمِينِهِ وَعَنْ شِمَالِهِ. Whenever he's in a ghazwa, I would be on his right or on his left. And any time there was danger coming from front, I would be in front of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And any time there's danger coming from behind, I would be behind protecting the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I never left the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alone between him and the enemy. I was always in the middle. حَتَّى تُوفِّيَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So Suhaib, he get the highest credentials. I mean, like Abu Bakr and Umar. He was in Badr, he was in Uhud, he was in Al-Khandaq and Al-Mashahid kullaha. In the hadith narrated by Anas radiallahu anhu, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم السباق أربعة. Those are the Olympic golden medal winners. Four. أنا سابق العرب. وصهيب سابق الروم وسلمان سابق فارس وبلال سابق الحبش. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and see the, here is a compliment for Bilal and Suhaib and Salman, for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to put himself in the same category. He said, I'm ahead of all the Arabs, Suhaib ahead of all the Romans, which means Syria basically, and you know who is from Syria also, Zayd ibn Haritha. He had the same story. He was, you know, been sold in slavery and was sent to Mecca. And Salman radiallahu an sabiq Faris, and Bilal is from Ethiopia, from Abbasin, sabiq al-Habash. Suhaib was a scholar. He narrated 307 hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Very beautiful ahadith is narrated by him, and we might know some of them, like ما آمن بالقرآن من استحل محارمه. Anyone who does those unlawful, those major sins, and he claims he's a Muslim or carry the Quran, he did not believe in the Quran. So this hadith came to us from Suhaib. عن Suhaib قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما آمن بالقرآن من استحل محارمه. Also, he narrated the hadith, beautiful hadith, that hadith that in the Day of Judgment, when the people enter heaven and the people enter hell, a loud voice will talk to the people of heaven that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a promise for you and He wants to fulfill His promise now. فَيَقُولُونَ مَا هُوَ أَلَمْ يُثَقِّلْ مَوَازِينَنَا وَيُبَيَّضْ وُجُوهَنَا وَيُدْخِلُنَا الْجَنَّةِ وَيُخْرِجُنَا مِنَ النَّارِ فَيَكْشِفُ لَهُمُ الْحِجَابِ فَيَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. With all the pleasures of heaven, thus they were very happy and satisfied. But that munadi, that call, is telling them, you have more. And they say, what's more? And they will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَا شَيْءٍ أُعْطُوهُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّظَرِ إِلَيْهِ. And they have found that exposure eclipse all the pleasures of heaven. Suhaib, with all his serious life, tragedies, slavery, the treatment of Quraysh, and the wealth of his hard work for many years gone, still never lost his sense of humor. He had a sense of humor, and the Sahaba knows that, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows that. And one time, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted, and you know, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't like we are, serious, you know, in every little thing at home. You know, if there's a little problem, you find everyone frowning. No, with all the immense weight on his shoulder, amana, and weighing the whole universe, he was always smiling. And if there's any good time for a practical joke or something, he would not hesitate. Always you find a smile on his face. So one time he saw Suhaib and with the companions, and they were eating dates. And Suhaib came with a pink eye. One eye was pink. So he sat down and joined in eating the date. And here the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, you're eating date and you have pink eye on the right side. He told him, oh Prophet of Allah, I'm chewing the date on the left side. So فَضَحِكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alaihi wasallam حَتَّى بَدَتْ نَوَاجِزَ. So that means he laughed till the scissors, Now before the molar, the nawajiz is the scissor, the sharp teeth here. Anyab, we call it anyab for the animals, anyab like what you see in the, when the lion or the tiger open his mouth, those big, this is, we call it in Arabic, nawajiz. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, and he was pleased with Suhaib, like with all those companions of Badr and Uhud and Bay'at al-Ridwan. And after Abu Bakr, we know Umar ibn al-Khattab became Khalifa. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu an, in his governing place, he had a guard at the door who would organize and prioritize those who will enter to see him. I mean, he has limited time and things has to be in order. So one day, the great leaders of Quraysh and the Bedouins came. Suhail ibn Amr. You know Suhail ibn Amr? He's the one who signed the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. He became Muslim later on. Also, Uyayna ibn Husn and Al-Aqra' ibn Al-Habis. Those are the leaders of Al-Arab. They are very powerful people. And the guard at the door, he stopped them. And another group who came, he let them, the guard let them enter without, you know, even stopping them or asking them. And that group was Suhaib and Ammar. So usually when they come to Omar, he put them on his right and his left. So they were irate, the great leaders. They said, those people come first and we stay at the door. And here Suhail ibn Amr, after he became Muslim, and he was an orator, and really he did a great job when the people started jumping out of Islam after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He prevented the people of Mecca to have any ideas or thoughts to do such a thing. So Suhail ibn Amr, using his common sense, he calmed down the anger of those big leaders. He told them, du'u wa du'ina. They were invited to Islam and we were invited. فَأَسْرَعُوا وَأَبْطَأْنَا. They hurried up and they became Muslim and they fought with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and so on. And we dragged our feet. It's more than that. They fought Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, and if you are jealous and envious, or jealous maybe, not envious, now at the door of Omar, wait till the day of judgment. You will be more jealous in the day of reckoning. When Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was stabbed by Abu Lu'lu'a al-Majusi, and we know he fell and he continued to pray with his condition till his last breath. So in that 2-3 days, he ordered Suhaib to fulfill his place, to fill his place. So Suhaib was appointed by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and you know who's there. Every Sahabi there outside Abu Bakr who died, you know, before him, and the great leaders there, he asked Suhaib to be the Imam till, and he appointed a shura, 6 people, from those 10 who received the glad tidings of being in heaven. We know Abu Bakr died, Umar is dying, so who's left? Uthman, Ali, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Abdurrahman ibn Awf, Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Zubair ibn Awam. The other two also died, Abu Ubaidah Amr ibn Jarrah and Sa'id ibn Zayd. So those 6 are the who are left from the 10 who received the glad tidings being in heaven, and they've been many ahadith mentioned specifically for their rank and status in the sight of God. So he appointed Suhaib to watch that shura and make sure they will appoint one of them. And if they have to disagree, to use power, you know, the sword of the Sultan to settle their scores or settle their dispute. Suhaib was appointed the temporary governor or temporary khalifa. So this is a great, you know, recognition for Suhaib radiallahu anhu. And another certificate in his credentials, when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu died from that stabbing, Suhaib was the one who was requested by Umar to make prayers on him. So Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he died, Suhaib Arroumi was the Imam who did the janazah prayer. And Suhaib lived till the year 38, he was in his 70s, early 80s, year 38, when Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, karram Allah wajha, was the Khalifa in Kufa, but Suhaib was in the Medina. And he died naturally. And the one who did prayers, janazah prayers, was Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, another one of the 10 who received glad tidings to be in heaven. So as you see, Suhaib is from the highest among the Sahaba in the caliber of the 10 who received glad tidings, as-sabiqoon al-awwaloon, as-sabiqoon as-sabiqoon. Suhaib ibn Sinan journey was not in vain. We need to learn a lesson when calamity or disaster or things happen against your immediate vision or will, not necessarily is bad. I'm sure he and his family were so upset and when he fell to slavery. And the same thing when he was sold in the market too, but he's destined to be with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As in Zayd ibn Haritha, when his own family came to claim him, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was a young boy before the Ba'tha, wasn't it? That his father and uncle came to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, told him, we need our child, our son. So he gave the son the choice. And Zayd ibn Haritha has chosen Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam over his own father and uncle and going back to Syria. So I hope we learned some lessons from that, that keep trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do your best, be moral, be good, spread humor and fun around you, and inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will go where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala planned for you to be a giant, to fulfill your potentials. Inshallah, next week we will talk about another sahabi, inshallah, if I live, of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.